Local broadcast of News 5 is supported in part by a grant from Southern Bell, a Bell South company.
Those great musical memories are yours to love again on the Lawrence Welk Show. Join your favorite musical family each week on this public television station. Music, dance, and lots of family fun with America's Music Man. Don't miss the Lawrence Welk Show.
Saturday evening at 7 on WUFT Channel 5.
All I want is a room somewhere when you play me the jazz, hot baby.
It's Julie Andrews in concert, so you know it's going to be a great performance.
Wednesday at 9 on Channel 5.
WUFT-TV, Gainesville.
Production of this program has been made possible in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the Southern Educational Communications Association.
Mr. Simon, bring me a dream.
The Florida of the 1950s and 60s is still real to me, captured in the pages of scrapbooks and snapshots. Home movies reveal a Florida of ingenuous charm, not idealized, not romanticized. It was the Florida of mom-and-pop motels at the seaside, of little concrete blockhouses dwarfed by a banyan tree in the front yard. Miami Beach meant Wolfies, and the amazement of the brand new Fountain Blue. Mostly, except for the Biltmore Hotel or the Breakers, the palm trees rose up higher than the buildings. And that was part of the picture. On the beach, you looked up and saw seagulls. My family, like millions of other Americans, vacationed in Florida quite a few times during the 50s and 60s. Not long ago, by any historian standards. And yet, the intersection of U.S. 441 and Hollywood Boulevard, it is possible to see what Florida is becoming today. An endless cacophony of shopping centers. From Key West to the Panhandle, as rapidly as Florida is building its future, it is losing its past. The two are not always cause and effect, but our lust for progress has driven us to trample much of our history, be it illustrious, or ignominious, or simply and gloriously commonplace. It is in our architecture that we can see it. For architecture is the reflection of culture, the expression of our accomplishments. Once grand hotels stand empty, with no future but dereliction. Fishing communities are becoming tourist traps. The simple beachfront cottage, the unassuming mom-and-pop motel, all that has virtually vanished, replaced by high-rises towering over the sand dunes and the sawgrass. All over Florida, growth and change are relentless.
I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places.
The people come into Florida, to Florida's growth, boom, whatever we want to call it, in my opinion, was caused by the man that invented the air conditioner. We didn't have a problem. They came and visited in the winter, and they went away because no one wanted our Florida summers. The air conditioner, in my opinion, changed all that. And I have to admit that before I would face spending the winter in, and I don't mean to put the areas down, but Baltimore, Philadelphia, Cleveland, et cetera, across the north, I would rather be in the worst area of Florida.
Florida is a place, is a state now that has about 12 million population. In the course of the past 10 years, it has accepted between 7 and 8 million new residents. That has to change the place. It's losing the physical history, the buildings you see, and it's losing the environment because there are more people to share the environment. There are more people with a little piece of it, so there's less for each of us to have and to understand.
The threats to the state's architectural tradition, the saga of a developer moving into a neighborhood and demolishing all the old buildings is typical. For sale signs stand in front of numerous properties, historic or otherwise. It is Florida's continuing story. Of course, there has always been growth to contend with. Roughly from 1822, the year Florida became an American territory, and settlement began in earnest. But for the first century and a half, the people who built Florida still thought it was a special place, and they rejoiced in its potential for romance and entrancement.
I've always thought Florida was special for two reasons. One, the climate, the wonderful climate, and the relatively warm winters. Thing because of the natural surroundings, the beaches, the lakes like this one, the rivers. It was a place more of communities, people, neighbors who knew each other better. It was a more of a southern state than it is now. Less sophistication, less international in its outlook. It was more of a place of small towns than it is now.
The fishermen who settled in Florida came from Nantucket and the shores of North Carolina. They brought along the architectural traditions of other places and other times. They settled in villages tucked away along the coast. Green Fernandina, Cedar Key, Apalachicola, Key West. But where once fishermen dried their nets, suburban shoppers now price macrame. High-priced yachts, charter fishing boats, and tour boats fill marinas where only hard-working fishing boats used to dock. Processing plants have given way to restaurants, and weather-beaten neighborhoods sport new coats of bright paint. Cedar Key, a tiny island midway between Tampa and the Panhandle, was a sizable lumber shipping port and a pencil manufacturing center in the 19th century. Bypassed by the Cross Florida Railroad in 1886, it was then virtually destroyed by a hurricane 10 years later. For most of this century, the population hovered at 900.
I started fishing when we moved to Cedar Keys when I was 8 years old. Caught the first bunch of fish. I caught 1,000 pounds of mullet by myself.
It was a quaint, delightful place, with its requisite complement of artists and writers, along with mullet fishermen.
Cedar Key in 1967 was a sleepy little town. And the change in the last 20 years or so has been both good and bad. Fisheries were the most important economic part of the town in 1967, and they're still major, but there's a decline in fisheries, so that sports fishing is taking over the harvesting of oysters, harvesting of stone crabs, and I think there's a good deal of resentment at the change on the part of many of the natives of Cedar Key.
You can't catch certain fish, and the fishermen have always been able to catch them. there's no reason for this to happen to the commercial fishermen. That is why a lot of them are giving it up. And a lot of them are younger people know that the sport fishing is asking for more rules and regulations, and they're getting them.
Cedar Key has also become a trendy tourist destination with chic boutiques and high-priced housing. In the last decade or so, the annual art and seafood festivals have drawn up to 100,000 people. Now the harbor promenade spills over with shops selling ceramics and t-shirts to the occupants of new tin-roofed condos and motels that march around the island's perimeter.
As we change from a fisheries-based economy to a tourism-based economy to support through structures on the dock, that kind of economic base for the community. But it must be controlled, it must be managed, and it must be planned to preserve the community. Where it goes from here will depend on what the people of Cedar Key want for this community.
First call, gentlemen. First call.
Tarpon Springs, just north of Clearwater, was settled first by Midwesterners. Later came the Greek fishermen who established Tarpon Springs as a sponge diving center.
The sponge industry was the largest industry in Florida for a period of 30 years. It was bigger than tourism, it was bigger than citrus, it was bigger than everything. Tarpon Springs was the main port simply because the sponge exchange was established here in 1902. This was a focal point for the industry. It was a place to store the sponge and a place to do business. They had the auction block there, and all of your auctions were held in Tarpon Springs. It was not only a focal point for the industry, it was a focal point for all the cultural movements that the Greek community had, or all of the affairs.
The next sponge diving show will start in just 2 minutes.
Then came the tourist attractions. At Spongerama, loudspeakers announced the next multimedia history of Tarpon Springs. A wax museum offers the three-dimensional version. And tour boats depart on the half hour to show off sponge diving techniques.
Thank you.
It is all very corny. But somewhere along the way, the old Tarpon Springs attractions were deemed not enticing enough. A developer tore down all but half a dozen cells of the old sponge exchange and built a shopping mall. The new Tarpon Springs Sponge Exchange is a crisp white, blue-trimmed Bauhaus-style building. It is very tasteful, very restrained, and entirely out of place in this tacky, touristy town.
When they tore down the sponge exchange, you tore the heart out of the sponge dock area and the sponge industry. I wasn't only upset, I went to war with it. We needed a shopping, modern shopping center in the dock area like we needed a hole in the head.
Small yellow, 7 lines, and 38 pieces. You are bidding on 687 wool, 14 lines.
The real stuff of Tarpon Springs, the sponge diving, almost died out. But recently there's been a resurgence brought about by the demand for natural sponges and by the sudden disappearance of sponges from the Mediterranean. Thus, Tarpon Springs hangs on by a thread.
The demand right now is something like 20 times greater than the supply on the world market. Today, at the auction that you were witnessing, sponge went for $50 and $60 a pound. I'm hoping that if this thing continues, if the flow continues, and it looks like it is, because there's been no relief in the Mediterranean, then if the city or the state doesn't put up a sponge exchange, George Beliers will. I can guarantee you that.
While we crush our real villages, we are building fake ones along the waterfronts all over America. In Miami, there is Bayside, a huge waterside shopping center. Its metal roof market sheds are a mere reminiscence of the old fishing pier building that once stood along Biscayne Bay. You can buy fish at Bayside, but the shrimps are served peeled and with cocktail sauce. The grouper comes filleted and fried. You can buy t-shirts at Bayside too, and suits and luggage, and, to the delight of my 7-year-old son, toys.
I want this. May I have the shark too?
The sadness is that our children will not partake of the true heritage of the American independent fishermen. They will not the beguiling brusqueness of a fishing village at work, for all they will ever see are the make-believe versions. Once, and not too long ago, fishing villages were for fishing. Florida's famous freshwater springs offer another sharp lesson in history, for once they shared many similarities. Now they offer only contrasts.
Well, I'd like to say good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome you all down here to Wauwatosa Springs State Park on our river cruise.
Wakulla Springs near Tallahassee, now a state-owned park and conference center, offers us a glimpse of nature as earlier tourists viewed it. Wakulla Lodge, though rustic, still sports the kinds of comforts the knicker-clad adventurers of the 1920s would have expected.
This is the largest spring in the world. Flows over 600,000 gallons of water per minute.
Well, I hope everyone enjoyed the tour.
A jungle cruise takes its passengers over the deep, dark, clear water, gliding over fish, past alligators.
Alligator up in the bush on your right.
Now I'm gonna take you on back out in the shallow water now. Gonna take you out in the little fish convention. Now that's where I'm gonna call a little fish up to the glass. Yeah, but it's all right.
For a century, the springs of Florida drew in the tourists for their restorative powers, for their exotic flora, fauna, and fish. The simple pleasures of Florida's past are just not profitable these days. Tourists speed by them, leaving beautiful Rainbow Springs, once a popular attraction, to a tangle of weeds. Rainbow Springs is now the private property of a sprawling subdivision that bears its name. The springs that do draw tourists have found a formula: assembly line boat rides and monkeys. At Silver Springs, one of the world's true natural wonders with springs over 100 feet deep, you walk past a dozen souvenir shops, photo and food stands before finding the first natural sight. The famous giant catfish are scarcely to be seen anymore, but there are plenty of tourists. Over 1 million people visited Silver Springs last year.
Yeah.
The urge to turn almost everything into an attraction affected the old town of St. Augustine in a very ironic way.
What you see on St. George Street is about half and half. Authentic colonial buildings and buildings that have been put up to look like colonial buildings, a touch of Disney World.
Settled in the 16th century, St. Augustine is America's oldest city. It didn't really bloom until the late 19th century, but in recent years, the authentic St. Augustine has been in jeopardy, threatened by those who would tear down real 100-year-old buildings and replace them with pretend 16th century structures.
St. George Street was our old downtown Main Street with Sears Roebuck and the pharmacy and all those places on it. And it is no longer. It's not a place where you drive in and do your shopping. It's our tourist area. Colonial style buildings have been reconstructed on the site, and it's really changed the look of St. George Street, and tourists like it, and we like it. A lot of people in St. Augustine for many years said, well, look, what we're famous for is colonial buildings, therefore everything else is Victorian garbage, and let's tear it down.
The story of St. Augustine is repeated in different ways all over Florida. We are constantly trying to recreate ourselves here, to start anew. But in recent years, that has come hand in hand with the destruction of what came before.
You had some surviving colonial buildings. Some of them, terrible things had been done to. Modern storefronts had been put on them and everything. And those buildings were restored, but there weren't enough of them to give the street ambience of colonial St. Augustine, so they took a lot of the other buildings that were there and tore them down and reconstructed. So now it's shop after shop of t-shirts and ice cream parlors and rubber alligators.
A century ago, it was different. When Henry Flagler came to St. Augustine, he set about to make it into a city more Spanish than some in Spain.
Flagler's time, you had people of great wealth coming down here. You had the grand hotels, the Ponce de Leon and the Alcazar and the Cordova. You had winter cottages and mansions built for wealthy people. So it gives a very interesting legacy.
For the Ponce de Leon Hotel in St. Augustine, Henry Flagler chose a young decorator who would furnish window carvings, paintings, and chandeliers, and designed some stained glass windows for it as well. His name? Louis Tiffany.
None other than Louis Tiffany, who became famous for his stained glass, was the interior decorator of this building. Mr. Flagler imported about 300 Italian artisans to come over and do the handicraft work, the hand-carved wood, the hand-laid Renaissance floor in the rotunda. The murals were done by George Maynard, who was a very famous artist at the turn of the century, and they were done in gold leaf. So there are a number of factors that I would say, would suggest, that would make this a very significant structure architecturally.
It was supposed to be the finest hotel in the world, and perhaps for a period of time it was. But I think it certainly set new standards for a hotel in looks and size and architecture. And the architects of the Hotel Carrere and Hastings became recognized leaders in the world in the field of designing hotels.
From rugged comforts to Renaissance splendor, Florida always drew in the dreamers. In the beginning.
Hasn't this been a wonderful program about Florida? These wonderful shots of St. Augustine and the Ponce de Leon Hotel, the shots of Cedar Key and Tarpon Springs. If you enjoy this kind of programming, ensure that this type of programming continues to come to you day after day, then the number for you to call is 392-5555 1-800-338-WFT. Good evening. I'm Melissa Murphy, and I'm down here in the studios of Channel 5, and we're in about the middle of our spring pledge drive, and we need for you to go to the phone and dial 392-5555 and give a vote of support, a pledge of support for Channel 5, for public broadcasting, and the kind of programming that you're enjoying right now. I'm a Floridian, I'm a Florida native, and I am enjoying this program so much because I remember going to Silver Springs, to Tarpon Springs, to Weeki-Wachee when I was a child, and that is something that I want to see survive here in Florida. So if you would like to support this kind of programming that we need to hear from you, 392-5555. I'm here in the studio with my friend Henry Penzis, and we're going to be going now to give you some more information.
Well, again, I'd like to talk about how easy it is for you to show your support for this type of very localized and special programming. All you need to do is walk to your phone, dial 392-5555, or if you're out of this area, dial 1-800-338-WUFT, and then you'll get one of our volunteers from the Gainesville Apartment Association, and they'll pick up the phone, and they'll ask you a few questions. It takes about a minute and a half. It's something that you can do right now, and if you do it right now, you won't miss any more of this program as we get back to it. Once they've got that, they'll ask you a couple of...